Howdy, fluff butts, it's me, Frolin Walpaw and Cortez Colt. Yay or nay reviews are back. Thank you so much to all of you once again for reaching the likes goal with the Griffin review. You've been smashing it recently and it makes me very happy. Let's go for another goal, shall we? If you want to see a review made on the next episode, Dragonshy, like this video right away. How about 8 likes this time? Reach that goal and that video will be made. Okay, now that that's complete, let's begin the review. Oh man, I have been waiting so long to review this specific episode for such a long time. Before production of Generation 4 began, Hasbro sought for the show to include central themes of friendship learning and establishing many ways its intended demographic can be inspired from it. When you boil Friendship is Magic Season 1 down to a simple viewpoint, you can almost buy it off as one massive citizenship lesson. The diversity of friendship morals that are built into the fabric of each episode is individually unique. For example, you have the Ticketmaster, spreading a message that sharing your blessings is caring. Applebox Season, with the belief of letting your friends help you can make your life easier. Griffin the Broshoff, that displays encouragement for you when to learn the difference between real and fake friends. And then we have Boastbusters, who tell us that being cool is uncool. Wait, what?
What?
I got to be honest, this episode is quite the eccentric one. It is infamously known as one of the most negatively acclaimed and publicly despised episodes of Season 1. Boastbusters is all about
the great and powerful Trixie
coming into Ponyville with her traveling magic show, claiming she's the most powerful unicorn in the world. Meanwhile, Twilight deals with a personal fear of showing off her true sorcery in case she gets seen as a boastful person, like what every pony believes Trixie to be. Believe me, you're going to be thrown with a ton of repetition with 5 certain words in this video. Normally, I strive to be neutral with these reviews, keeping a fine sense of acknowledgement for both sides of an episode's story. However, with this episode, it's going to be a huge challenge. Concerning the problematic fame of the episode, the controversial writer, and the introduction of a new antagonist. Was Boastbusters Season 1's first major misstep? Or is it actually a hidden gem overlooked by many?
Please, please don't hate me.
Hate you?
Well, release a couple of fireworks and grab a witch's hat, because we are going to examine Boastbusters and see if it gets busted.
Ghostbusters!
That was such a bad joke. I'm sorry. Despite the miserable reputation that this episode holds, I truly feel sorry for Boastbusters, because it was originally planned to be a big step up for Season 1. Over 8 new characters were supposed to appear in this episode to expand the talented cast, but the writer of the episode proposed that only 3 of them make an appearance. Trixie Lulamoon, the apparent villain of this episode, was initially meant to be a stallion. Yes, it's true, Trixie is a transgender! For real though, if the concept of Trixie being a boy actually went through production, it would have made Boastbusters a fantastically realistic tale, where our main female character gets publicly humiliated by a male upstart, leading to a startling point in time where the girl stands up for herself against the boy that tried to openly scorn her. Trixie being a stallion could have been the first glimpse of maturity in the show. However, once again, the writer instead made the boastful pony a mare, and I find it difficult believing what people have against Trixie being an unfavorable character. She simply isn't. Taking into account her occupation as a magician, you can predict her to behave exaggeratedly, apart from her catchphrase,
"The great and powerful Trixie!"
Her self-centered behavior is surprisingly minimal in the episode. Her third-person speech pattern is great for comedic effect.
Like any pony with a dash of good sense would think twice before tussling with the great Trixie.
And Trixie is also a perfect twisted parallel for Twilight Sparkle, displaying how a proficient person can gradually become a bragger if they show off too much. Take note of Twilight's constant modesty throughout the episode.
What do you mean? I'm nothing I'm special.
Yes, you are! You're better than her!
I'm not better than anyone!
It's my girl.
Ghostbusters opens up rather shortly. We learn that Twilight has performed 25 types of magic, and we don't even get to know what they are. Instead, we're put for a speech coming from Spike where he would plan to show off his mustache to Rarity.
Hello, Rarity! What's that? Oh, it's nothing. Just my awesome mustache.
Remembering that Spike is a
baby dragon
and has adored Rarity from the very beginning made this scene honestly boring. There's nothing eye-catching about it because you're suddenly taken away from the apparent feats of magic that Twilight has conjured.
Growing magic? That's number 25.
This is the second time Spike's crush on Rarity has been mentioned in the series, and it doesn't serve any practical purpose in the episode at all. A dog and pony show is a brilliant case of this matter taken the correct way, but when Spike's fascination for Rarity comes up in random intervals like this, it comes off as creepy. It's a great influence on the audience to be kept in the light when it comes to knowing things that our characters know on screen, and when Spike tells us that Twilight cast over 25 spells, while only seeing one of them, the last one.
25 different types of tricks, and counting.
We feel cheated that we didn't get to see what the others were.
Oh, come on!
The episode starts outside, with Twilight and Spike engaging in conversation about the knowledge of the magical abilities of unicorns in Equestria.
I thought unicorns were only supposed to have a little magic that matches their special talents.
True, for ponies whose talents are for things like cooking or singing or math. But what if a unicorn's special talent is magic?
This brings up an interesting concept related to the be yourself friendship lesson embedded into the story. What if your powers are the pure manifestation of the idea itself and not something branching off of it? This hypothesis is rather convenient, but I couldn't imagine it being fitting to any other character than Twilight. She finds comfort in not taking credit for all of her accomplishments, as she has regularly had her friends to back her up. Although this chit chat is ruined by Spike's praise for his mistress.
Like you, Twilight, and you know a ton of magic.
I'm sure there are lots of ponies right here in Ponyville that know just as much magic as me.
Are you kidding? I don't think there's another unicorn in all of Equestria with your kind of ability, Twilight.
He does this so many times throughout the episode, and I hate it. Spike has been shown to be more mature for his presumed youth in the previous episodes, and Ghostbusters forgets all of that, turning him into a clingy white knight.
Yeah, since we all know that Twilight here is. And besides, Twilight, she's just a show-off. Unlike Twilight, but you're the best!
It's time to stop!
Their conversation is cut short with the rushed arrival of two of the most annoying characters in MOP history, Snips and Snails.
There is a new unicorn in town!
Yeah, they say that she's got more magical powers than any other unicorn ever!
Who are essentially a Pinky and the Brain ripoff.
Not...
They run into Twilight and Spike to tell them that a new unicorn has come into Ponyville. One thing that I don't understand about this interruption is how can Spike know who Snips and Snails are?
Snips! Snails!
But not Trixie. You'd think that Trixie is a somewhat popular icon around one or two parts of the world, which I'm willing to grant her. There would be some recognizabilities of her talents within groups of people. Sure, Snips and Snails are shown to resign in Ponyville, but the episode gives us the impression that they are kind of assistants to her, when in reality, they're just Trixie's thirsty only fans.
Trixie truly is the most talented, most magical, most awesome unicorn in Ponyville.
No! In all of Equestria!
Fuck's sake. This moment was so gratuitous. We then cut to a crowd of ponies surrounding the town square, where the perfectly introduced
great and powerful Trixie
takes center stage performance-wise. Her first 15 seconds of fame is such an ingenious spectacle. Trixie takes on the persona of an ostentatious trickster that doesn't want to let the spotlight go. I found it fascinating how it made me deeply ponder whether she sincerely felt like a star, or Trixie was only putting up a wall between her true feelings of being a failure and this facade she's adopted to make herself seem better than what she actually is. Take Eddie from Ed, Edd and Eddy, for example, two characters who had been rejected from civilization because of personal connections, believing that they were weaker from the norm. And after finally gaining that longed-for liberation, they fabricate a fake identity in an attempt to attention-seek popularity instead of facing the hurtful truth that they fear deep down, thinking that they wouldn't be so socially accepted for what they consider themselves to genuinely be.
I made it all up, Double D. Everything about my brother was a lie. I made things up so people would like me. Think I was cool.
And speaking of that show, did you know that Trixie and Marie Kanka are both voiced by Kathleen Barr?
Take it and make it good.
Hello, princess.
In your dreams, weirdo.
Real magic.
After the magical fanfare, this was the moment when the rest of the episode fell to pieces. The dialogue here is just so awful that it sounds like it was written by a kid in primary school.
My. What boasting?
Rarity, how is Trixie any different to the walking case of egotism you literally hang around with?
Especially when you got me around being better than the rest of us.
Element of loyalty, Mares and Gentle Colts.
There's nothing wrong with being talented, is there?
Nothing at all. Sitting when someone goes around showing it off like a school filly with fancy new ribbons.
Okay, who the fuck wrote this crap again? Chris Savino? Oh yeah. The guy that has had multiple sexual harassment allegations against his name. That's a surprise.
Well, well, well. It seems we have some naysayers in the audience.
Ugh, Trixie. Why did you have to go ahead and spoil the review's results for us?
Spoilers.
These insults coming from Twilight's friends are really uncharacteristic that I struggle to believe that it's actually them in this scene. What justifiable arguments do they have against Trixie?
Just because one has the ability to perform lots of magic does not make one better than the rest of us.
She's a bloody magician, not some megalomaniac.
So great and powerful, Trixie. What makes you think you're so awesome anyway?
She's an enthusiast in the sector of stage magic, not viciously putting down newcomers because they're not willing to interact with her.
Sitting when someone goes around showing it off like a school filly with fancy new ribbons.
It's a flipping show! It's her job to show off. Isn't that the point? The fact that she briskly comes up with the story of vanquishing an Ursa Major without any pony questioning the certainty of the tale and instead taking it for granted truly made me feel sick.
How about you?
Oh my god, that sting was so fucking hilarious. Twilight's friends then begin to challenge Trixie on stage with their own acts against hers, and I seriously couldn't contain my laughter in this sequence. It was ridiculing to see Applejack, Rainbow Dash, and Rarity manipulated and fooled by Trixie. They fell right into her hoofs and it's their own fault. I guess you can call Trixie
the great and powerful
troll. It's understandable why Twilight wouldn't want to try and stand up against Trixie. You feel pity for how much she currently feels overburdened with peer pressure.
Someone with some magic of her own?
Yeah! A unicorn to show this unicorn who's boss!
The rapidly fired shots of the crowd pony staring right at her made me feel firmly uncomfortable, securing how we should assess the situation she is congested within. And that's not a compliment, because it feels so coerced.
Well, Twilight, I guess it's up to you.
What do you mean? I'm nothing special.
Yes, you are! You're better than her!
Shut the up!
Unlike Griffin the Brushoff, which featured Pinkie Pie standing up for Fluttershy against Gilda's behavior, that exact conflict happens here, and it's just not as convincing. The way that Spike purposefully goes after Trixie and her brown noses as if he's trying to solve some big mystery doesn't work at all for his submissiveness. Why did I say that word?
Wink!
Remember me saying that Slices and Slugs being seen as somewhat assistance to the
great and powerful Trixie?
Legitimately, the next segment solidifies that perception as they are handing her her drink by means of mooning.
This yo smoothie was for with extra hay, just how you like it.
Snips, you realize that you're a hornhead as well, right?
I can't believe you've done this.
This was definitely one section in the episode that pained me to watch, but I did like seeing Trixie with her tiny wagon. Like Unlike her magical abilities, it's tangible that she's an amateur, with not even a proper mode of transportation on hoof.
The great and powerful Trixie doesn't trust wheels.
It is transportation!
Unfortunately, my little minute of enjoyment straight away turned back into annoyance when Spike comes along to have a small confrontation with Snips and Snails.
The great and powerful Trixie vanquished an Ursa Major!
Were you guys actually there?
Well, no.
Respect has to be given to Spike for attempting to be the voice of reason here, but the execution is so bad.
The proof is in the pudding.
I like pudding.
I am Buttertoast!
Spike is rightfully uncertain about the supposed truth of Trixie's story, although I think this scene would have achieved it better if Spike went to Trixie rather than blowing it out with cuts and trails.
Unless an Ursa Major comes waltzing up the street for Trixie to vanquish, I am not gonna believe a word she says. And neither should you!
Damn, Spike, you've already shot the messenger. How about you slaughter the dispatcher too. We transition to the inside of Twilight's house, where Spike begs for Twilight to challenge Trixie on who's better.
Didn't you see how they hated Trixie's bragging, Spike? If I go out there and show off my magic, I run the risk of losing them as friends.
You'd be using your magic to stand up for your friends.
Her being so dismissive of Spike's demands was quite respectable. It was supported by her many anxious expressions to display her inner dread of being made a fool in front of many.
It's not the same thing, Twilight.
Well, categorically, it is the same thing, and Twilight even knows this.
No, Spike, it's exactly the same.
Twilight and Trixie are the same species, and although this has potential for them to have a proper competitive duel, if Twilight used her magic with the added hint of stage fright, she'd be a laughingstock. Without any danger involved, would be considered very unnecessary.
Gaze upon an ever greater and powerfuler Trixie!
Maybe one day I'll get to that other awful episode in season 3.
Any one of these tricks, even the teeniest, would be enough to show up Trixie.
Would be helpful if we knew what they were at the start.
You idiot!
Then the scene miraculously ends on a light note, with a door gag and Spike storming out, much to Twilight's relief.
That's where you want to be? Then fine.
Hey look, it's the argument proof door!
You know what? Fine!
Fine!
Yeah. With their beliefs blown back on them from their skirmish earlier, Snips and Snails attempt to find an Ursa Major. Yet again, this scene didn't stand out to me being one worthy of attention. Remember this exclamation from Trixie from the show before?
Vanquished the Ursa Major and sent it back to its cave, deep within the ever-free forest.
She never explicitly said where they reside, and the fact that slashes and leeches manage to conveniently stumble upon one sleeping is beyond me. Oh, and what a surprise! Spike is also happening to be strolling around outside at this exact point when Slits and Worms come running out of the cavern in horror.
Get up now!
Got a major problem!
Ha ha ha. The comic relief of this script is such a downgrade. I will say that I love the design of the Ursa Minor, along with the reveal of the real Ursa Major later on. Based on the actual constellations they are named after, their unique appearances are wonderful. Even the sheer size of them contrasting with the comparative size of the pony sent a chill down my spine. Not just that, but here's what the Major was originally going to look like. That's terrifying. It's a massive shame though that these splendid creatures won't surface up in the show ever again. Well, in a matter of principles, the Major does make an appearance. Pointlessly.
Oh, I'm learning so much.
Discord!
How dare you!
Frightened out of their wits, the SSS call upon their beloved mistresses to take out the Minor. Legit, couldn't they have screamed out for any pony else with more fruitful sorcery? Nope, lead it directly into the depths of Ponyville, allowing it to be possibly destroyed. The writer really was still spilling hints that Trixie was in fact a fake, when in actuality, we already know this.
Great and powerful Trixie, you've got to vanquish the Ursa! It took a lot of trouble to get that thing here!
I detest this forced pressure on Trixie.
But you're the great and powerful Trixie!
Now remember, you defeated an Ursa Major!
Just do it! Yes, you can!
Not only were her OnlyFans overtly ignoring her concerns, they are blindly feeding her scanty confidence so she can vanquish the Minor on her own. During this entire sequence, I was yelling at the screen saying,
"You're hornheads too! Help her, you dumbos!"
Help! Help! Help!
Snix and Escargot getting irritated at Trixie's plain failures made it a vast struggle to watch.
Aw, come on, Trixie!
Stop goofing around and vanquish it, eh? Well, that was a dud.
Yeah, come on!
Don't you think it's a bit strange how the Minor was roaring in the middle of the night, in the middle of Ponyville, for 2 minutes of runtime, and only now the citizens are getting rudely awakened? What untimely rubbish is that?
Know your fucking place, trash!
Twilight gets caught in the crossfire, and this was the moment where Trixie redeems herself by confessing the truth of her story.
I can't.
What?!
I can't. I never have. No one can vanquish an Ursa Major. I just made the whole story up to make me look better.
She's saying sorry for forging and bragging about the story that she overwhelmed an Ursa Major. But of course, this deserved apology has to be ruined by the over-exaggerated editing of the Brown Nose's unbelievable reactions.
I just made the whole story up to make me look better.
Oh my god, she did what?
With no other options available, Twilight Sparkle assertively stands up to the task and puts her true amount of magic on full display. Now this was astounding to see play out. The way Twilight hastily deals with the Minor with little trouble kept my eyes glued on the action. This defines Twilight being the most dependable pony out of the main six, once again defining her expanding characterization.
Nice use of number 16.
This would have been extremely useful if we knew what kind of sorcery she was performing at the start.
I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not gonna take this anymore!
With the Minor safely back with its mother, Ponyville congratulate Twilight on saving them until they all decide to pick on Trixie one too many times again.
I know how much you all hated Trixie's showing off with her magic tricks, and I just thought—
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Magic's got nothing to do with it.
Nani?
What the hell are you talking about, Rainbow? It was precisely magic that solved it. She made you all a mockery on stage, so you can't say that.
Blow it up again!
To finish off this frustration, Trixie makes her exit in hilariously mediocre fashion.
But you will never have the amazing, show-stopping ability of the great and powerful Trixie!
It's such a joke, and I like it.
Now, about you two.
we're sorry that we woke up the Ursa Minor.
You know what makes this segment so stupid? It's the stills of the pony standing in the background. They don't show any emotion or even move for a full 10 seconds.
Now, about you two.
we're sorry that we woke up the Ursa Minor.
We just wanted to see some awesome magic.
It's like this has suddenly turned into a Hanna-Barbera cartoon.
Gang, it's only a power failure.
Twilight punishes Snips and Snails to cleaning up Ponyville for the trouble that they ended up causing. This deserved notion gets thrown out the window because Twilight resorts to giving them mustaches instead. I honestly cannot begin to tolerate this flawed climax. Problem number one, with the amount of sorcery that Twilight executed a mere 2 minutes ago, I don't even believe that the little twats cleaned up their mess, because they basically got off scot-free. We don't get shown footage of Snips and Snails doing any sweeping around, so it's hard to believe what Twilight was condemning them to. Problem number two.
Maybe someday she'll learn her lesson.
Exactly what lesson was Trixie meant to learn? Lying about being able to get rid of an Ursa Major?
No one can vanquish an Ursa Major. I just made the whole story up to make me look better.
Sure, this idea makes Trixie seem like kind of a dick, but did she expect this to happen? Thus, want this to happen? No, she's not an antagonist, but I guess that's what the writer wanted us to believe.
What a load of rubbish.
Problem number three, when Ponyville verbally despised Trixie for being a braggart.
Trixie's just a loudmouth. Most unpleasant. All hat and no kettle.
They don't seem to realize that Twilight expresses who truly inspired her to stand up for the town. I'll give you one guess. Twilight saving Ponyville was solely because of being inspired by Trixie's talents and remark of the creature itself. If Trixie never boasted her magical feats in the first place, Twilight would have never stood up against the Miner and would stay mentally in fear of losing her friends.
I was so intrigued by Trixie's bragging that I was compelled to do a little reading up on them.
Damn, son!
Okay, enough of that. Let's get this over with. The epilogue is still slightly cringy because it appears as if Spike's influences have finally seeped into Twilight's head.
Finally admit that you're the most talented unicorn in all of Ponyville?
Well, yeah.
It would have been better if she didn't say anything at all, and then Spike rambles on about his date with Rarity to no end.
She didn't go for the mustache. Or maybe the mustache wasn't enough. Maybe if I had a mustache and a beard.
Oh, not this again.
I'm right with you there, Twilight. Fucking end. So, repeat this after me, Fluffbutts. Was it a yay or a nay? God almighty, what a train wreck this review was. I know I said I was excited for this review, but now I just feel like shit again. Well, mares and gentlecoats, things are finally changing on the Yay or Nay series. It is going to be living up to its name for once. This episode is going to be garnered the very first Nay!
Woohoo!
Nah, this episode doesn't even deserve the time of day. Boastbusters is an absolute disaster. Rewatching this episode for this review made me realize that I was right to be unsatisfied. This story is dreadful and doesn't accurately take advantage of the message it had. The antagonist it attempts to create out of Trixie comes off as laughable and feels like a flop when she vaguely displayed any kind of villainous traits. Twilight's friends behaving like stereotypical bigots against Trixie was so annoying. Not to forget Scissors and Bugs doing the same for Trixie. Several scenes lingered on for too long as well, like the release of the Miner and Twilight's friends being foolish on stage. Uncharacteristic performances, dull writing, and lazy editing. Boastbusters has the deluxe package of what makes a story so bad. There were some silver linings though, with Twilight's praiseworthy modest attitude before her final awesome moment with the Miner. Trixie was definitely the co-star of the episode with her clever remarks and fun egocentric nature. Overall though, this episode was unbearable. I already know that Dragonshy is going to be immensely better than this pile of trash.
Let's go!
Let's not.
And remember, Fluffbutts, get this video to 8 likes and that review will be made. I award Boastbusters, a nay, and a 2 out of 10. Oh dear, the quality in the tier list is dipping like a death drop ride, and for that reason, Fluffbutts, Boastbusters is ending up with a very disappointing E rank on the Season 1 tier list. This episode is just not worth it, and I wouldn't bother watching, unless you want to see some cool Twilight antics then. Whatever. There we go, Fluffbutts. That's a wrap for my 6th MLP review video. Thank you once again for supporting this series of videos. I never expected to get this far with it, but I guess my expectations have truly exceeded me. Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to my channel for more exciting content. Do leave a comment down below too on what your thoughts were on about Boastbusters and if you agree with me or not on my review. And I'll see you all very soon. Goodbye!